Do you think it's possible for a person to change into someone completely different? And do you think it's possible for this transformation to occur well into one's adulthood? Is it possible for a man to come into the public spotlight in the 1950s as a combative, heartless conservative with a killer instinct, to somehow morph in the 1960s into a soulful, compassionate, liberal fighter for social justice? People have been arguing that question about Robert F. Kennedy for 50 years. You are listening to In the Past Lane, the podcast about history and why it matters.
We the people of the United States, in order to form a more...
The huddled masses yearning to breathe free.
Consider that we shall be as a city upon a hill.
That all men and women are created equal.
Give me liberty or give me death.
Nobody's free until everybody's free.
The government of the people, by the people, for the people, shall not perish from the earth.
History matters because it's not just about the past. History's about us, here and now. It explains the world we live in and why things are the way they are. And history gives us insights into how to achieve a more just, peaceful, and prosperous future. So people, let's do this. Greetings, everyone. Welcome to In the Past Lane, the podcast about history and why it matters. I'm host Edward T. O'Donnell, your historian at large, and this is In the Past Lane, Episode number 5. We are coming to you this week from the Cuban Missile Crisis Studios, located somewhere outside of Boston, Massachusetts. Our brilliant executive producer is Lulu Spencer, the straw that stirs the drink that is In the Past Lane. You can learn more about me, this podcast, and our guests at our website, inthepastlane.com. You can also follow us on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram. And you can help us out by subscribing to In the Past Lane at iTunes or wherever you access your podcasts. And then, this would truly be wonderful, leave a starred review and a comment. Reviews are so very important for pulling in new listeners. Thanks. This week at In the Past Lane, I interview best-selling author Larry Tye about his new and highly acclaimed biography about Robert F. Kennedy, perhaps the most enigmatic of the Kennedy brothers. Okay, people, this is no time to be running errands. Your journey in the past lane begins now. All right. Before we bring on Larry Tye to talk about his new book, let's take a few minutes to sketch out the basic details of the life of Robert F. Kennedy, or Bobby, as most people called him. Robert F. Kennedy was born on November 20th, 1925. He was the seventh of nine children and the youngest son. His father, of course, was the ambitious, wealthy financier Joseph P. Kennedy. His mother was the daughter of a prominent Boston political family. Bobby Kennedy grew up in a life of wealth and privilege, attending the very best private schools. During World War II, he served in the Navy, and in 1948, he graduated from Harvard. 3 years later, he earned a law degree. In 1952, Bobby Kennedy managed his older brother John's successful campaign for the United States Senate. The next year, in 1953, Kennedy began working as an assistant counsel to the dogged and belligerent anti-communist crusader, Senator Joseph McCarthy. And it's here that Bobby gained a reputation as a tough, hard-nosed investigator of alleged communists in the U.S. government and Hollywood. Many people in Washington spoke of him as a ruthless and at times vindictive political operative. No one saw him as an idealist. In 1959, after gaining more national attention for his investigation into corruption in organized labor, specifically the Teamsters Union headed by Jimmy Hoffa, Bobby Kennedy again agreed to help his older brother John win an election, this time the presidency. When JFK won, he named Bobby as Attorney General. The young Robert F. Kennedy was unprepared for the job. But over the next 3 years, he played a key role in his older brother's handling of everything from the civil rights movement to the Cuban Missile Crisis. When JFK was assassinated in November 1963, Bobby was devastated. In his grief and in his despair, he was uncertain about what to do. but Bobby Kennedy ultimately decided to run for political office in his own right. In 1964, he entered the race for the Senate in New York State, and he won. And it's here, in the mid-1960s, that the image of Bobby Kennedy underwent a dramatic transformation. The guy known as the right-hand man of Senator Joseph McCarthy, as an enemy of organized labor, and as an impediment to the civil rights movement, now emerged as a champion of 1960s liberalism, of justice and opportunity for African Americans, of the eradication of poverty, and of opposition to the war in Vietnam. And it's this seemingly sudden transformation that has led, in the opinion of biographer Larry Tye in his new book, Bobby Kennedy, The Making of a Liberal Icon, to the emergence of a vastly oversimplified understanding of who Robert F. Kennedy truly was. It's the idea that somehow there were two Bobbies, the bad Bobby and then the good Bobby. The real story, as Larry Tye tells it, is a lot more complicated. Stay with us, people. We'll be right back.
You are listening to In the Past Lane, the podcast about history and why it matters.
Okay, we're back. With me now is Larry Tye. Larry Tye is a best-selling author of many works of nonfiction, including Satchel, The Life and Times of an American Legend, and Superman, The High-Flying History of America's Most Enduring Hero. Today, we are eager to speak with him about his latest book, a new biography of Robert F. Kennedy titled Bobby Kennedy, The Making of a Liberal Icon. Larry Tye, thank you for speaking with us today at In the Past Lane.
Good to be with you.
I want to start off by asking you about what drew you to the subject of Robert F. Kennedy. You know, his oldest brother, JFK, in some ways is the most famous Kennedy, and his brother, Ted, was the most accomplished Kennedy, simply because he had such a long Senate career. And Bobby Kennedy, in some ways, is the most mysterious Kennedy. He's the hardest one to figure out of the three. So what drew you to this famous but somewhat difficult to understand man?
What drew me there was two things. One was just what you said, that we knew about Jack. We've had 50 years to get to know Ted. And Bobby was, to me, not just the most mysterious, but the most interesting. I think he was the most passionate, sort of the most Irish and untamed of the Kennedy boys. He was the one who, when he took on a cause, it became not just something that he could intellectually grasp like his brother Jack did, but it became the kind of passion that was a model for his brother Ted. And Bobby also was the one who left us when he was killed on the eve of his great victory in the California presidential primary 48 years ago, back in 1968. He left us with all these what ifs. What if he had actually become the nominee? What if he had become the president? What would America have been like with 4 or 8 years of Bobby Kennedy running things instead of Richard Nixon?
Yeah, many of the Kennedy, you know, the stories of several of all the brothers really do present a lot of these great what ifs. And I think certainly the Robert F. Kennedy one is one of the biggest. So one of the other things that it's clear from your book that intrigues you about him is that the part that the public knows about him is a, like you say, a liberal icon, a bit of a hero worshiping and saintliness. It seems clear that that obscures the real Robert F. Kennedy or the parts of Robert F. Kennedy that we really should know. It's sort of overdoing it in one direction. So let's start with the sort of his early career, where the thing that people most associate with Robert F. Kennedy in his early career is his role as a quintessential Cold War warrior. He's working as an aide to Senator Joseph McCarthy in the early 1950s. And this seems like hardly the beginning for somebody who will emerge later as this great liberal icon, as you point out. So how can we explain this early phase of Robert F. Kennedy's life?
Sure. So the consistency with Robert Kennedy is whatever his passion was at the moment, he really engaged with it fully and sunk himself into it. And it happened, maybe not surprisingly, in his early years, his passion was some of the conservative values that he had been raised with in the house of Joseph P. Kennedy. He was a quite passionate Cold Warrior. He believed that communism, in an era when much of America believed that communism was the abiding threat, so did Bobby Kennedy. And he was a perfect reflection of what America was in 1950. He believed the most legitimate and the most successful communist chaser, guy who was going to root communists out from our government at a time when we were worried about spies named Ethel and Julius Rosenberg, and we were worried about the Red Menace. Bobby Kennedy was passionately involved with his first boss, Joe McCarthy, and stayed on with him for about 7.5 months, doing some of his most respected and effective investigations of communists in the government, and more importantly, of American and allied support for shipping that was also helping our communist enemies in Korea. And Bobby was passionately involved with this, and it was just a very different ideological Bobby Kennedy than we saw at the end. And to me, it's one of the things that makes him most interesting. The idea that this guy started out as somebody very different and learned and changed and reflected America as it was changing from the 1950s to the 1960s.
That's interesting, because I think a lot of Americans have a very strange and very inaccurate understanding of the 1950s, particularly the anti-communist aspect of the 1950s and Senator McCarthy. And in 1950, the early 50s, I think most Americans thought of anti-communism as a very progressive, idealistic endeavor, that it was about human rights, it was about human dignity, it was about freedom. And it seems to me that, as you point out in your book, that Robert F. Kennedy sees that. It's not, anti-communism is not some vicious witch hunt that is out to destroy people. It does become that in some ways, but it also has this idealistic aspect to it that is often overlooked.
That's true. And so there are two ways of looking at what Bobby Kennedy was doing then. On the one hand, what he was doing was he believed in the pure version of what you're talking about. He believed that he was coming in an era where we saw Joe Stalin for what he was and for the ruthless dictator that he was. And Bobby Kennedy was very concerned about protecting American democracy, and the biggest threat to it was the Soviet totalitarian form of communism. This was after sort of the sense of the more idealistic communism in the earlier days of Lenin. On the other hand, what Bobby Kennedy didn't quite see was the excess of Joe McCarthy. He saw that Joe McCarthy's top aide, Roy Cohn, was somebody he didn't like, and he felt that he was going overboard, but he never quite got that McCarthy was the one who enabled Roy Cohn, and that McCarthy was grasping onto this legitimate anti-communism and in a lot of ways giving it a horrible name by going to such excess that it wasn't anti-communism anymore. It was McCarthyism, ignoring First Amendment, ignoring civil liberties, and compromising the very values that he was supposed to be preserving.
And I think another interesting aspect is how popular anti-communism was and how popular Senator McCarthy was, quite frankly, in those first few years of his public profile on this topic. I remember talking to my father about it, who was born roughly around the time of Robert F. Kennedy, and he shocked me because I had a kind of a shorthand version of the 1950s, and he shocked me when he said, oh yeah, we all thought McCarthy was right. We thought he was the only one who had the guts to say what needed to be said. And I was shocked to hear that. And subsequently, that appears to be, upon further investigation, you realize that most Americans in the 1950s were not afraid of Senator McCarthy. They were afraid of Stalin and afraid of communism.
You're absolutely right. And we don't have to go very far to see a contemporary analogy. And to me, the analogy is Donald Trump. And Donald Trump is tapping into a very legitimate and important to understand discontent of people who feel they've been left behind by everything from the American economy to a general sense of empowerment in the American political system. And in my mind, he's taking it to an excess, and he's giving a lot of that discontent a bad name and a racist name and a xenophobic name. But the instinct that he's tapping into, he would not be the Republican nominee if there wasn't something legitimate in terms of what he was tapping into. And Bobby Kennedy saw that same legitimacy in what Joe McCarthy was trying to do. And anytime you do a biography, you're trying to tell a big story through somebody's little story. Me, the Bobby Kennedy biography is partly the story of Bobby Kennedy, and it's partly a lens into America of the 1950s and the 1960s, when Bobby Kennedy was, in my mind at least, one of the seminal figures of both of those eras. Played incredibly important roles. He was a little like Woody Allen's Zelig character, it was popping up everywhere that something big was happening, whether it was the McCarthy movement, whether it was civil rights, or the Cuban Missile Crisis. Bobby Kennedy was always there. He was always front and center, and he was always doing something that I think is a little bit different than how history has thought he was doing things.
Yeah, he does seem to be really present at the moment, at these key moments in that roughly 20-year period. Another key part of his story is once his brother Jack is elected president, he becomes the attorney general. And again, this kind of popular image of Robert F. Kennedy when it comes to his work for his brother on the topic of civil rights. Robert F. Kennedy is in some ways best known for authorizing the wiretapping on Martin Luther King Jr.'s telephone and behind the scenes trying to slow down the civil rights movement. And some people would even accuse him of sort of trying to stymie it altogether. So how does that square with this? Because this is now early 60s, 62, 63. How does that square with this emerging, more iconic image of RFK as this liberal icon?
In everything that we're talking about, Bobby Kennedy went through a learning curve. And it wasn't flip-flops because he was often moving in the direction that was less politically popular. But civil rights is a classic case of it. He started out really, I think, not getting what was going on with the movement. And with the early demonstrations, the Freedom Riders trying to integrate the interstate bus system, or whether it was people trying to integrate the University of Mississippi and the University of Alabama, Bobby Kennedy was more worried at the beginning whether this would make America look bad when his brother Jack was having summits with Nikita Khrushchev, whether it would make us look bad overseas, and less concerned with the legitimacy of what these protests were all about. He thought people should be going slower. He thought his Justice Department, when he was Attorney General under his brother JFK, he thought his Justice Department was bringing a lawsuit to try to do what he thought was the most important thing, which was to bring in African-American voters. He thought if you enfranchise blacks, you will necessarily make a political system more responsive. And yet, lots of black leaders back then said, we're not going to go slowly. We have been going slowly for 100 years, and we need change, and we need it now. And Bobby Kennedy was slow to see that, and yet once he did see it, like with anything, he became the most impassioned advocate of all. And Martin Luther King was one of the first people to understand the potential in Bobby Kennedy. He understood that he was a learner, even if it was a slow learner, and he told his top lieutenant, there's something good in this guy, and we've got to figure out a way to bring out good. And they did that.
Yeah, I think there are other civil rights leaders also who, Marion Wright and others, who were shocked by when they finally got to see him on the ground, particularly after 1965, that they were shocked by how authentic he was and how he truly did care about these issues and was moving far more in their direction, leaving behind that more cautious, that more politically savvy Robert F. Kennedy.
It's true. And Marion Wright Edelman saw that very dramatic situation in Mississippi, in one of the poorest parts of America, which is the Mississippi Delta. And Marion Wright Edelman was then Marion Wright, a young civil rights lawyer who had testified when a bunch of U.S. senators came to Jackson, Mississippi to try to see whether what she had been proclaiming about starvation in America was true. She testified at this hearing in Jackson. And after the hearing, all but two of the senators flew back to Washington for the weekend. Bobby Kennedy said, I want you to show me what you've been telling me about. And he went to the Mississippi Delta with her and another senator, Joe Clark. They went into some very dilapidated shacks of tenant farmers in the Mississippi Delta. And he sat on a floor, on a really dirty floor, with a little boy who was barely functioning. And he started trying to talk to the boy about what he had been eating. And what he saw in this situation was, firsthand, a little boy whose refrigerator had only peanut butter in it, who was clearly starving. And he saw firsthand in the Mississippi Delta how poor blacks were living, how Americans were starving. And when he went back to Washington, he met the next Monday with Orville Freeman, the Secretary of Agriculture. He convinced him that there really were Americans who were starving and that he had to change the food stamp program. And as a result of Bobby Kennedy, changes were made. As a result of what she saw that day, Marion Dwight went from being a disbeliever, cynic about him, into a lifelong fan of his. She ended up marrying Peter Edelman, his aide who was with him that day, and it changed her life, and it changed her perception of Bobby Kennedy in the way of that everybody who saw him up close in those kinds of situations came away a believer.
So, and that's in 1967, so that's when he himself is a senator. A lot of times people overlook his career as a senator. They sort of skip from the attorney general years to the run for president. Is there anything else in that, his time as a senator, that stands out as, and in particular stands out as part of this evolution, this transformation of Robert F. Kennedy?
Yes. So we talked about the early Robert Kennedy in the 1950s. We talked about Bobby Kennedy as a senator. The critical intermediate period, aside from what everybody knows about when he was attorney general, to me, the most critical moment in his life was the day his brother was shot. He was there watching the reaction to his best friend, his boss, and the person who he was closest to in the world being gunned down. And he was, on the one hand, the most stalwart and the strongest person in America at a time when the country was sort of falling apart. Everybody was in mourning. And Bobby Kennedy was there directing funeral preparations, directing transformation of the government from his brother to the vice president, Lyndon Johnson. He was there as the strongest of people. But at a moment, a month or two later, when the country was getting it back together, when Lyndon Johnson was really assuming in a strong way the presidency, and when everybody else was getting back to a kind of normal existence, Bobby Kennedy lost it. He went through a period of many months of what we would today call clinical depression. And I think that was a transformative moment for him. He understood that no longer was he going to be able to hitch his professional wagon to his brother, whether it was running his campaign for Senate or running his presidential campaign or running his Justice Department. He had to figure out what he wanted himself. And at moments, he thought that maybe what he wanted was to go off and do what you do, which is be a college history professor. Or maybe what he wanted was to just go off with his family and wander around Europe for a while. And he had millions of dollars in a legacy fund, and he could have done that. And he finally decided what he wanted to do was get back and fight for the very issues that he and Jack had been fighting for during the early Jack Kennedy presidency. And so he decided the best way to do that was to get out of Washington, which was to go to New York, and was to run on his own and see whether he could win a Senate seat. He beat a popular Republican incumbent. He really found himself during that campaign. And he came back as a passionate advocate for the issues that we were talking about a minute ago, of fighting poverty in America, or taking on his sitting president, his party's sitting president, on the issue of the Vietnam War, and on being the liberal icon that we knew him as ultimately in that 1968 campaign to president.
So it's an integral part of that transformation of Robert F. Kennedy.
It was. So, and it was also, to me, a transformation in these days when we think, when any politician changes, that it's flip-flopping of convenience. Bobby Kennedy was going through a heartfelt and real transformation that kept the passion but changed the ideology and made him the really sympathetic and, I think, historically attractive, tough liberal that he was at the end of his life.
Yeah, we demonize and criticize people that change their mind. And, of course, historically, in the biographies of great leaders, almost all of them, you see that one of the things that makes them great, whether it's Abraham Lincoln or Theodore Roosevelt or business people like Henry Ford, it's their ability to change and to make shifts, important shifts, even at a political or business cost, because they begin to see things differently and they're not afraid to act on that.
It is. So it's a difference to me, if we were going to use words to describe it, it's what I would call growth versus retrenchment or convenience of the moment. And I think that what Bobby Kennedy was really doing was growing, and the way he learned was by getting down on a shack with a little starving kid and trying to talk to this kid, trying to understand up close in a way that almost none of his fellow senators would do what the real problems of America are. And he was doing that not when he was campaigning for anything, but doing that when he was being a senator and was trying to understand what was really going on.
Okay, it's time for a short break. When we return, I continue my conversation with Larry Tighe about his new biography of Robert F. Kennedy. As we go out, let's listen to the words of Robert F. Kennedy in a speech he gave on April 5th, 1968, one day after the assassination of Martin Luther King. And you can hear in his voice and in his words a mix of despair and hope. You'll also hear Kennedy say three times that life is short. 2 months later, Robert F. Kennedy would be dead from an assassin's bullet.
Violence breeds violence. Repression breeds retaliation. And only a cleansing of our whole society can remove this sickness from our souls. For there is another kind of violence, slower, but just as deadly destructive as the shot or the bomb in the night. This is the violence of institutions, indifference, inaction, and decay. This is the violence that afflicts the poor, that poisons relations between men because their skin has different colors. This is the slow destruction of a child by hunger and schools without books and homes without heat in the winter. This is the breaking of a man's spirit by denying him the chance to stand as a father and as a man amongst other men. And this too afflicts us all. For when you teach a man to hate and to fear his brother, when you teach that he is a lesser man because of his color or his beliefs or the policies that he pursues, when you teach that those who differ from you threaten your freedom or your job or your home or your family, then you also learn to confront others, not as fellow citizens, but as enemies, to be met not with cooperation, but with conquest, to be subjugated and to be mastered. We learn at the last to look at our brothers as alien men with whom we share a city, but not a community. Men bound to us in common dwelling, but not in a common effort. We learn to share only a common fear, only a common desire to retreat from each other, only a common impulse to meet disagreement with force. For all this, there are no final answers for those of us who are American citizens. Yet we know what we must do, and that is to achieve true justice among all of our fellow citizens. We must admit to ourselves that our children's future cannot be built on the misfortune of another's. We must recognize that this short life can neither be ennobled or enriched by hatred or by revenge. Our lives on this planet are too short. The work to be done is too great to let this spirit flourish any longer in this land of ours. Of course, we cannot banish it with a program nor with a resolution, but we can perhaps remember, if only for a time, that those who live with us are our brothers, that they share with us the same short moment of life, that they seek, as do we, nothing but the chance to live out their lives in purpose and in happiness, winning what satisfaction and fulfillment that they can. Surely this bond of common fate Surely this bond of common goals can begin to teach us something. Surely we can learn at the least to look around at those of us, of our fellow men. And surely we can begin to work a little harder to bind up the wounds among us and to become in our hearts brothers and countrymen once again.
You are listening to In the Past Lane, the podcast about history and why it matters.
If you are enjoying this podcast, then please subscribe to In the Past Lane at iTunes, Stitcher, or wherever you access your podcasts. Subscribing is free, and once you do it, new episodes of In the Past Lane are automatically downloaded to your listening device. Subscribing also gives you access to the entire back catalog of In the Past Lane episodes. And if you do subscribe, please leave a review. Thanks.
All right, let's return to my interview with Larry Tighe. When we left off, Larry had explained the profound transformation of Robert F. Kennedy into a liberal crusader for social justice. Now we turn to Bobby Kennedy's controversial decision to enter the 1968 race for the presidency.
It's a year later in that period that he makes the extraordinary decision to jump into the race for the Democratic nomination for president of the United States. Maybe you could just tell us a little bit more about that. It's a very crucial moment in this story.
Yes. So Bobby Kennedy decided to jump in when Lyndon Johnson was still running, but when he had been weakened by just barely beating Gene McCarthy in New Hampshire. And Bobby Kennedy had been pushing himself back and forth on this seesaw of whether to jump in or not. He disagreed with the president on the Vietnam War, disagreed with him on how to wage the war against poverty, disagreed with him on what he felt was LBJ's inability to understand sort of the discontent in America, that the young people were out in the streets protesting, and it wasn't just the war. It was a general sense of there being something wrong with our democratic system. Bobby Kennedy, having watched what happened in New Hampshire, decided that Dean McCarthy wasn't the right standard bearer, that it was time for him to take on LBJ. And in what ended up being an incredibly ham-handed entry, where on the one hand, McCarthy hated him for waiting until after McCarthy showed LBJ's vulnerability, and LBJ hated him for jumping in against him, Bobby Kennedy jumped into the race. And it was not the beginning that he had envisioned. It was not the kind of campaign he thought that he would run 4 years from then, or maybe 8 years from then. But he decided he couldn't wait any longer, jumps in, and he has a tough time finding himself. It wasn't until his big victory in the Indiana primary, which was the first really contended one that he jumped into, that he understood just what he was running for and who he was. And he was really running on a two-tiered platform of fighting poverty and fighting to get us out of a war that he thought was the wrong war.
It seems like kind of an amazing choice because, as you say, there's terrific risk in jumping into the race because it could actually derail any future plans if it goes really, really badly. So he jumps in the spring of 68 and then has a couple of months to campaign and seems to be gaining steam, particularly winning in June in Los Angeles or in California. And that's where the tragedy of his assassination takes place. Is there anything new to know about the assassination other than it was just yet another one of these horrific benchmark moments of the 1960s?
So there are a lot of things to know about the assassination. One that is interesting to me is that the Kennedys always had this stigma associated with them as being anti-Semitic, because Joe Kennedy may have been anti-Semitic, and he certainly was an appeaser when he was the ambassador, the American ambassador to London, an appeaser of Hitler, and suggesting we should sort of sit out the war rather than taking on the Nazis. And there was always a sense of anti-Semitism maybe involved with him. The irony that it was because of Bobby Kennedy's strong support for the Jewish American community and of Israel that set off this guy, Sirhan Sirhan, a Palestinian, to do this political assassination. And it was just extraordinarily tragic. At a moment when it really looked like Bobby Kennedy was going to be the nominee and could well be the president, the idea of him being gunned down. There are loads of assassination theories. There are supposed inconsistencies in the investigation of the Bobby Kennedy assassination, the same way there were questions raised about the JFK assassination. But I've seen nothing that made me believe that it was anybody other than Sirhan Sirhan. But I think the important thing is not who killed him. The important thing is, and he seemed in California by winning very convincingly in the Latin community there, in the Black community, and in large parts of the white community, he seemed to be building a unique coalition of building bridges between Black and Hispanics and Native Americans and blue-collar white, between young and old in a way that nobody seemed to be able to do then, and even between rich and poor. And for a guy who sort of grew up in a lily-white, very wealthy world, getting to know at a very young age kings and queens, popes and presidents, this guy was extraordinary in reaching out to a coalition of people who had nothing. He was becoming the kind of tender conservative or tough liberal that 50 years later, much of America still yearns for. And it just was really tragic that at the very moment when he was giving us the greatest reason to hope, he got gunned down.
As you say, but that aspect of Robert F. Kennedy does raise one of the great what-ifs of American history, one of American political history. Well, and I guess what you just said also explains one of the questions I was going to ask you was, why does Bobby Kennedy matter today? But I think you just effectively answered that question, that he embodied something that many people today think would be or is sorely needed in our political sphere. One thing I wanted to ask you regarding that your role as a biographer, you've written many biographies, including biographies of icons. So I thought that was kind of interesting connection with this one on Robert F. Kennedy. But clearly, and you very openly state in your preface that you have great admiration for Robert F. Kennedy, and that presents certain challenges for a biographer. In some ways, a temptation is there to play into the sanctification of a figure that you're writing about. But you took a different tact and decided to really take on these aspects of Robert F. Kennedy that are less savory, less angelic, so to speak. Can you talk about how you approached this difficult balance and what you were thinking of? Like, was there a purpose behind doing it that way?
Sure. The fact is that I grew up with Bobby Kennedy as one of my political heroes. I went to high school with one of his sons, and in Massachusetts, you can't survive in Massachusetts, and certainly can't without being enthused by all this Kennedy speak. And so I think taking on the foibles of Bobby Kennedy wasn't a pleasant task. That's what you do as a journalist or a biographer in trying to get a complete picture. And I think people become much more believable when you understand the best and the worst and try to come up with a synthesis of what they were really like. And the truth is, at the end, Bobby Kennedy is more of a hero than he ever was for me. And it's partly because I think I understand him now a little better, warts and all.
That brings to mind for me the same kind of experience that other biographers have had, say for writing about Thomas Jefferson, that it's really difficult to take on a figure like Jefferson who has this iconic status, who wrote the Declaration of Independence, who has all these great accomplishments, but then to delve deeply into the troubling aspects of just one aspect, which of course is the fact that he owns hundreds of slaves and has a relationship with one of those slaves who bears many of his children. And yet that could lead you to sort of dismiss Jefferson as a fraud and a really evil person. But another way to approach it is to embrace that as just, he's a complex person, as all people are complex. And I see a lot of that in your approach to Robert F. Kennedy, that he's not a saint. He's a regular person who, like all regular people, is complex. And we have to look at both sides or all the different sides of that character.
It's true. And sometimes looking at it in today's world and in today's presidential race, Bobby Kennedy's downsides look mighty pale and his upsides look mighty tempting. And I think that he offers for us a real object lesson today, or at a time of national unrest comparable to what Bobby Kennedy was campaigning through in 1968, instead of offering answers of divisiveness, he was offering answers of building bridges between all kinds of different people. And I think he ought to be an inspiration today. So I'll take him, foibles and all, over any of our choices that seem to happen right now.
All right. That seems like a perfect place to end this. Thank you, Larry, for taking the time to talk to us at In the Past Lane.
Thank you very much.
Larry Tai is the best-selling author of many books. He spoke to In the Past Lane about his latest work, Bobby Kennedy, The Making of a Liberal Icon, out now from Random House. Let's end this segment by listening to the beautiful and just heartbreaking eulogy for Robert F. Kennedy, delivered by his brother Ted Kennedy from St. Patrick's Cathedral in New York City. It's the kind of eulogy that brings to mind the words of Senator Daniel Patrick Moynihan when he learned of John F. Kennedy's assassination a few years earlier. To be Irish is to know, in the end, the world will break your heart.
We loved him as a brother, as a father, and as a son. From his parents and from his older brothers and sisters, Joe and Kathleen, Jack, he received an inspiration which he passed on to all of us. He gave us strength in time of trouble, wisdom in time of uncertainty, and sharing in time of happiness. He will always be by our side. Love is not an easy feeling to put into words, nor is loyalty, or trust, or joy. But he was all of these. He loved life completely, and he lived it intensely. My brother need not be idealized or enlarged in death beyond what he was in life. To be remembered simply as a good and decent man who saw wrong and tried to right it, saw suffering and tried to heal it, saw war and tried to stop it. Those of us who loved him and who take him to his rest today pray that what he was to us and what he wished for others will someday come to pass for all the world.
Well, people, that's going to do it for this week's episode. I hope you found this episode both entertaining and informative. Please let us know what you think about it on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram. I also recommend that you check out our website, inthepastlane.com, because that's where you'll find a show page for this episode that includes show notes, links, essays, images, and further reading suggestions related to everything we've talked about in this episode. At inthepastlane.com, you can also learn more about our guests, correspondents, and other contributors. And I'd be most grateful if you subscribe to In the Past Lane at iTunes, Stitcher, or wherever you get your podcasts. And of course, please leave a starred review and comment. It really helps. Thanks. Many terrific people play a role in bringing you In the Past Lane. They include technical advisors Holly Hunt and Jesse Anderson, podcasting consultant Daryl Darnell of Pro Podcast Solutions, photographer John Buckingham, graphic designer Maggie Salucci, website by ERI Design, legal services Tippecanoe and Tyler Too, social media management The Pony Express, risk assessment Little Bighorn Associates, and growth strategies 5440 or Fight. And of course, we'd be nowhere without our executive producer Lulu Spencer. Special thanks also to Jay Graham for creating the intro music for this podcast, and to the Free Music Archive for providing the rest of the music for this episode. I'm In the Past Lane's host, Edward T. O'Donnell, your historian at large, reminding you that history explains our world, so let's pay attention to it. Thanks for listening. We hope you'll join us next time for another journey in the past lane. Hey Lulu, your fans want to know, what's the first thing that crosses your mind when you arrive at work every day?
I need a raise.
SBI, Snoring Beagle International.